Now, Father, then, want to pronounce the blessing together. Over ta Adonai Elohim Melech Haolam Asher Ketchanu Bemitzvotav Ditzivanu Lehitatev Batzitzit. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with his commandments and has commanded us regarding wrapping ourselves in seed. Amen. At this time, we'll have Yochanan ben Yehuda and Dan ben Yaakov to sound the shofar, as well as Yaakov ground. And with that, I'll give the blessing. Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher Kidshanu Bemitzvotav Vitzivanu Lishmoa Kol HaShofar. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with his commandments and commanded us to hear the sound of the shofar. Amen.
Avinu Malkeinu, our Father and our King, we thank you, Abba, for your blessings upon our lives. We thank you, Lord God, for your salvation, your grace, your mercy, your goodness in all seasons and at all times, that you protect us here in America. You protect those that call upon the name of the Lord in every nation, but especially you protect your chosen people, Israel, outside of the land, and those that are being brought back into the land, and those that are Sabras, Lord God, that are native-born in the land. We pray that they would rise up with the revelation of Yeshua as their Messiah, and they would turn the world upside down with the knowledge they have of not only the Hebrew tongue, but the knowledge that we find in Yeshua HaMashiach, the Anointed One. We thank you that Yeshua is lifted up today, that he may draw all men unto him, and as they follow him, they will also know the way, the truth, and the life. Father, I thank you, Lord God, for revealing that way of Abraham, Derek Hashem, to each one of us. Let us walk in the footsteps of our patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Let us walk and get through our wilderness the way the Israelites, the sons of Jacob, did. And Father, we pray that we'd press towards the promised land, Father, yes, and we God. Submit to your great authority, Father. Let us drink from the water today that comes from the rock of Yeshua. Let us also eat the manna that comes down from heaven, the revelation of your word, the very bread of life. And let us, Lord God, not grumble and complain, but let us learn to be cleansed from our old ways and walk clean and fresh. Give us a mikvah, a pool of immersion that we can just wash away all the things of our past and really allow the water of the Holy Spirit to cleanse us, the water of your Torah to instruct us, the water, Lord God, of your ways to lead us and to guide us. And Father, we thank you and praise you for this day that we bless your name. You are Adon HaShabbat, the Lord of the Sabbath. Father, this is the gift you have given us to enter into your rest. In Yeshua's name we pray. B'Shem Yeshua. Amen.
Praise Hashem. Praise Hashem.
At this time, I'd like to ask if there's anyone who has experienced loss during this week by any chance.
That are in
need of the mourner's cottage. Again, we did have there was an attack out in France yesterday, and we'd like to be able to pray for that person who lost her life to a rat, to put it that way. And again, no matter what, even when darkness shines upon it, it's starting to creep up, we are the ones who are to burn brighter and brighter, no matter how dark it gets. It is a spark that God has given, and that spark is what really brings hope to all mankind. And with that, I'll give you the words of Kaddish.
Yitkadal, yitkadash, shamev rabba, v'almadi brach yirute, v'yamnich malchute, v'chayechon, uv'yomechon, v'chayedechon be'Israel, be'ahagala, be'ahagala, uv'izman kariv, v'imeulu amin. Behesh me rabba me vorach. Le'olamonu me ol maya. Yiparach, yiparach ve'yishtabach. Ve'yitar ve'yroma ve'yitnase. Ve'yitadar ve'yitale ve'yithalal. Shmei dekodisha brichu. Le'le minkol birchata. Tishirahata. Tush bechata ve'nechemata. Dami rambama. Ve'yimeru amin.
Glorified and sanctified be his great name in the world which he has created according to his will. May he cause the reign of his kingdom in your lifetime and in your days, and in the life of all the house of Israel, speedily, yes, soon. And let us all say,
Amen.
May his great name be blessed forever and forever eternally. Blessed and praised, glorified and exalted, extolled and honored, adored and lauded be the name of the Holy One. Blessed be he who is high above, far above all blessings and hymns and praises and consolations which are spoken in his word. And let us all say,
Amen. Amen.
With that, let us unite our hearts as we turn to towards the east, and as we give the blessing of the Shema.
Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad.
Baruch Shevtevo, Malchuto, Le'olam Vatev.
Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. Blessed be his glorious name,
ואהבת את אדוני אלוהיך בכל לבבך ובכל נפשך ובכל מאודיך והיו הדברים האלה אשר אנוכי מצווך היום על לבביך ושנתם לבניך ודיברת בהם ושבתך בביתך ולבתך בדרך ובשוכבך ובקומך וקשרתם לאות עיניך, והיו לתותפות בעיניך, וכתבתם על מזוזות ביתך, ובישריך.
אמן. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. Let these words that I command you today be upon your heart. Teach them thoroughly to your children. Speak of them while you sit in your home, while you walk on the way, when you retire, and when you arise. Bind them as a sign upon your arm, and let them be frontlets between your eyes, and write them on the doorposts of your house and upon your gates. Amen.
Ve'ahavta le'racha kamocha,
and you shall love your neighbor as yourself.
Amen. And now I'll be given the blessing of Ein Kamocha, there is none like you.
Ein Kamocha ba'Elohim Adonai Ein Kemasecha. מלכותך, מלכות כל עולמים, וממשלתך בכל דור ודור. אדוני מלך, אדוני מלך, אדוני ימלוך לעולם ועד. אדוני עוז לעמו ייתן, אדוני יברך. את עמו בשלום. אב הרחמים, היטיב ברצונך את ציון. תבנה חומות ירושלים, כי בך לבד בטחנו. מלך אל רם ונישא, אדון עולמים.
There is none like you, O Lord, among the gods that are worshipped, and there are no deeds like yours. Your kingdom is forever. You reign through all generations. The Lord reigns. The Lord will reign forever and ever. O Lord, give strength to your people. O Lord, bless your people with peace. Father of compassion, deal kindly with Zion, according to your will. Rebuild the walls of Jerusalem, for we trust in you alone, O King, revered and honored God, Master of the entire universe. Amen.
ויהי בצוהר אהרון, ויאמר משה, קומה אדוני, ויפוצו אויביך, וינוסו משנאיך מפניך, כי מציון תצא תורה, כי Ki Mitzion Tetze Torah Udavar Adonai Yerushalayim Baruch Shenatan Torah Torah Baruch Shenatan Torah Torah Le'amo Yisrael Yidushato.
And when the ark would travel, Moses would say, Arise, O Lord, and let your enemies be scattered, and let them flee from before your face. For from Zion will go forth the Torah, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. Blessed be he who gave the Torah to his people Israel in his holiness. Amen. Baruch Hu Adonai HaMevorach.
Baruch Adonai
HaMevorach Le'olam Va'ed.
Baruch Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam Asher Bachar Banu Mikol Hamim Ve'natan Lanu Et Torato. Baruch Adonai Notein HaTorah. Amen.
Blessed the Lord, the Blessed One. Blessed is the Lord, the Blessed One for all eternity. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who chose us from all people and gave us the Torah. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah. Amen. Amen. Wow. Shabbat shalom and Boker Tov to y'all.
Shabbat shalom.
I'd like to ask if there's anyone who's here for the very first time or the first time in this building by any chance?
Yeah,
one person? We have one person?
All the way from Destiny Church in India.
Okay,
one of my students. Up.
Yes.
And anyone else by any chance?
All right, Ron, it's like you're the singled out one today. All right, wonderful. First-time guests, Hebrew students, and members of the congregation, let's surround today. Ron, you'll come to my left-hand side.
Amen.
Obviously, I'm giving away your first name. We normally ask you your first name in the city you're from.
Ron, from Bermuda Dunes.
Bermuda Dunes. Love it. Amen. Ron is not only a member at Destiny, but he's also one of my Bible college students and just completed 1 year of education and had to stand up with a group, give a thesis paper that took 10 pages that they all collaborated on. He did such an excellent job, I called him one of the three amigos. So he's a part of my new research team for creating curriculum. We also have another first-time guest. Samantha from Hemet, beautiful. Yep. Samantha, welcome. Yep. So we like to say you're a guest once, after that you're what?
Family.
In Hebrew that's? Mishpacha. Well, that's the Yiddish version. We'd say mishpacha. So we are honored to be able to do what Yeshua did. For some that are unfamiliar with this process, everything that just went on, called a Torah processional or the Torah service, is to honor God's word because like David said, I even posted that this week, on Instagram and Twitter and Facebook, oh how I love your law, which would translate, oh how I love your Torah. It was a picture at the MJAA conference that the photographer took of me, and I just fell in love with that picture, just catching me. I even was biting my lip. I was just like, I don't know what I was doing in that picture, but you know, it just showed the love that we should have for the Torah. And as when someone goes around holding the Torah, they're saying, I am embracing God's word. As they lift it up, they're saying, I'm lifting up God's word. And guess what? Yeshua is the word made flesh that dwells among us. So when we lift it up, it's like lifting up Yeshua. So when people take their tassel or their Bible and touch it or their hand and bring it to their lips, they're saying, oh, how I love your Torah. Oh, how I love your law. We're following the footsteps of King David. Amen? Amen. And so we have a Torah scroll that's probably 125 years old here. And it's written which direction?
Right
to left. So Genesis would be on this side, Deuteronomy at the end of this side. And basically, every week we go through a portion, starting in the beginning of the year with Genesis, Bereshit, and all the way to the book of Deuteronomy, Devarim. We are in the fourth book of the Torah, which is called Bemidbar, which translates into in the wilderness or in the desert. And so this is the book you probably know as the book of Numbers. And how many numbers of years in the wilderness do we have in this book alone? Not quite 40. We have about almost 39, about 38 plus years. Because remember, a little over a year they stayed at Sinai. And then when God said, move past Sinai, they wandered in the wilderness. And the book of Numbers gives us the major numbers of years they spent, and also numbers all the tribes, all the Levites, and all those that were enlisted in the army, and the priesthood, and it gives us quite a few numbers, doesn't it? And it even records many of the numbers of the journeys. How many different locations did they stop at? There was 42 locations from leaving Egypt all the way to getting to the border of the Promised Land. So we're excited that the book of Numbers is really a book about our journey, isn't it? It's not just their journey, it's our journey. It's not just their story, it's history. It's his story. So you can see Yeshua in every book of the Bible, amen?
Amen.
And you know, just like the serpent that's lifted up, the brazen serpent, so Yeshua had to be lifted up, according to John chapter 3, right? And when they looked at the brazen serpent, the serpents that bit them, their sting didn't bite as strong as long as they looked at the one that became that which came became sin for them. Right. So the bronze serpent, a serpent of sin, a symbol of sin, is actually bronze, an image or element of judgment. So God judged sin. How did he do it for us? Through Yeshua, who was lifted up. And so when we look at every story in the book of Numbers, we know it has significance. So not only their walk, not only the walk of those patriarchs and kings, priests, and prophets that would walk in God's ways, but it leads to the perfect king, priest, and prophet, which is Yeshua, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, prophet of all prophets. Amen.
Amen.
And we can actually hear Yeshua's voice when we read the Torah. Because what did Yeshua teach for 3.5 years?
Torah.
And then the prophets remind us of the Torah, but expand and speak to that generation of how to fulfill Torah. And the writings give us even more information, poetically and historically, on how to walk in the ways of Torah. When you get to the New Testament, all of a sudden there's this big divide, according to many Bibles, old and new. To us, it's one book, from Genesis to Revelation, and it's just book by book, step by step, a greater revelation of who Yeshua is, because it's who God is. Amen?
Amen.
So, we have another first-time guest. Wonderful. Your name is Cindy.
Oh, I'm Cindy. I don't have a synagogue. I go to Priest Chapel.
Okay, but what city are you from?
Oh, I'm sorry. From Sun Valley.
Well, you have a synagogue now. It's here. So anytime you want to come here, this is your home. So actually, I need you to come all the way over here so you can get as close to the Torah just like Ron is. All the first-timers, come close. I promise I won't bite unless it gets close to lunchtime. So, we're going to use a pointer. In our Hebrew class, we learned the letter Yud looks like a Yad, which is a hand. Okay? And so you see the hand there. The shape of the letter looks like the smallest letter in Hebrew, the 10th letter, which is the letter
Yud.
So not only do you have Yad, which is a hand, you have Yud, which is the shape of that letter, or that finger of God. And the Torah was written on stone tablets first by the finger of God. And so the cantor, which our chazan or cantor is Martin or Mordechai in Hebrew, and he will go space after space called a petucha, which is a door-like opening all the way to the corridor of each column, or sometimes the break will be a stuma, a closed mouth-like opening here. And so he will have to look after the break for the significant words, because in Hebrew, we name each book and each portion after the most significant Hebrew word that carries the essence of it. So the book we're in is Bimidbar. What's the essence of this book? They're in the wilderness. So in English, it gets Latinized, and then into English as Numbers because of the counting of years, the counting of people. But really, the ancient way is to take the essence of a word. So what we're gonna do is go from last week's portion, which was Korach, and remember he led a rebellion against Moses and Aaron, and the earth swallowed him, right?
Yep.
And 250 other leaders, and Datan and Abiram, two Reubenites from the house of the firstborn of Jacob, and sadly enough, bad leaders go where?
Down.
Downtown, not to Judy Brown, but to, they get humbled, don't they? But the humble get what?
Exalted.
So Moses was the most humble man on the face of the earth. So we're reading the writing of the most humble man on the face. Except until you come to Yeshua. Then the most humble man ever in all humanity is the one that never sinned.
Amen.
And that's Yeshua the Messiah. Amen.
Amen.
Does that tell you something about sinning? If we stay humble, we won't sin so much?
Right.
Because pride makes us what?
Fall.
Yep. Pride coming before destruction, haughty spirit before fall. So we absolutely know that Moses was, for the majority of his life, stayed humble. The few times he got arrogant is when he got angry.
Amen.
And so if you think about even humble people sometimes mess up. It kept him out of the promised land, didn't it? So we need to roll the scroll gently down the table and get to the portion called Hukat, or Hukas in the Ashkenazi. Hukas. Okay, so Hukat actually means a divine decree or a regulation stated by God that many times is beyond human understanding. Most of the commandments that are rulings that make sense are called what? Well, mitzvot is the general category of commandments, but we also have what? Mishpatim, which are the judgments of a mishpat, which is a judge. Okay, so we're going to actually look at a very unique huk, or part of the hukim. These are divine decrees that sometimes to our mind makes no sense. Okay, so we're going to let, you want to get your pointer? Okay, we're going to roll the scroll. Again, last week was called Korah, which is Korah in the Bible. And we're going to look for Hukat, okay? So, actually, we have here Korah right here. That is the beginning of last week's portion. So what we're going to do is roll from right to left. And obviously, we'd be looking at the significant breaks, looking for a portion that it says, as it does normally, Vadaber Adonai El Moshe, but instead of saying Lemor, it's going to say Ve'el Aharon. So it's going to speak, the Lord's going to speak to Moses and to Aaron. How interesting. They were the last two to be criticized in last week's portion. Wait a minute. You went a little quickly, didn't you? Go back here. Vadaber Adonai El Moshe Ve'el Aharon Lemor Zot Pukat. Okay, now. Before we go any further, what do we do when we see the name of God? How many letters is the name of God?
Four.
What do we call that in English?
The tetragrammaton,
which means five letters, or four letters, and that's Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, which is Y-H-V-H. Now, the guys that knock at your door that say they're his witnesses, with the little pamphlets, they pronounce it with a J sound, but the German J from the Gutenberg Press was really the Y sound, as in Hallelujah, spelled at the end, J-A-H. So a J is how? Is a Yah sound, okay? How about the letter W? It's a V sound, so Wagner is really Wagner, right? So we want to drink some Vata, right? In this Wasser, yes. Volkswagen, right, Volkswagen, yeah, exactly right. Perfect example of the sound that the W should have. So even people that say that his name, they recognize his name as Yah, but they add the word way at the end, they're trying to make the German W back into an American W instead of a German sounding V. Okay, so we need to understand that we don't know the proper way to pronounce the name of God. So out of respect to not take God's name in vain, this name right here, everybody come real close. See, here's the shape of that letter. The letter looks like a little comical in the air. We learned that it's the 10th letter in Hebrew, the 5th letter He, the 6th letter Vav, and the 5th letter He again, equaling to 26. Okay, so we see here that the name of God, when we read it, we actually say Adonai, which means Lord, or in conversation we say what?
Hashem.
So when you say Baruch Hashem, you're saying, blessed be the name. Hashem is the name, okay? So we're going to say Adonai in the reading. So I'm going to let our cantor, or our chazan, he will kiss the spot as a good bar mitzvah. He's the only one here that's actually been for fully bar mitzvah other than myself. So we'll let him go.
By the bed Adonai, El Moshe Bel Aaron Lemor, Zot Chukat HaTorah, Asher Tivah Adonai Lemor, Daber El Bnei Yisrael, Vikhu Elecha, Parah Adumah Tmimah, Asher Em Bah, Bum Asher, Lo Alah Lecha Ol.
I'm sorry, this isn't a comedy.
Unat Tem Otah, אל אלעזר הכהן, והוציא אותה אל מחוץ למחנה, ושחר אותה לפניו.
ולקח אלעזר הכהן מדמה באצבעו והזיב אז אל נוכח פני אוהל מועד מדמך שבע פעמים ושרף את הפרה דעיניו את אורך ואסרך ואת דמך על פלשה ישרוף ולקח הכהן עץ ארז וזוב ושנית עולת והשליך אל תוך שריפת הפרה.
Okay, טוב מאוד. So that was what, six verses? So let's get some highlights of the passage, and not the whole thing, but we start off with God speaking to Moses and Aaron, and then look what it says in Hebrew. Zot Hukat, which means this is the decree or the law of the Torah. So this means this is a very special divine decree of the Torah. And it's very strange, even to the wisest man on the earth, Solomon. And so we see here, it goes on to tell that the children of Israel are going to take a what? A parah adumah, which is a what?
A red heifer.
A red heifer. So we see that it's a heifer or a cow, and that they're going to take it, they're going to burn it, take the ashes, add it with water, and use hyssop, and also a very red cord called Tolaat Shani. And this is a red cord made from the innards or the fluid of the inside of a scarlet worm. And it was lost to us for years, but it has been found in Israel to make all the red garments for the priest and also the special cord. It was also used for the Day of Atonement, that it would miraculously turn white. Though your sins be as scarlet, it will become white as snow. When the sin of the atonement goat for the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, was on the altar. When that blood was placed on the altar, the cord would turn white. And the priest would come out declaring that Israel's sins had been washed away. The reproach of the nation blown away like the smoke from ash. And so in our lives, we need that national day of repentance, don't we? The National Day of Prayer to turn Israel back to the nation they were always meant to be, just like America needs a National Day of Repentance or Prayer to get back to where we're supposed to be, amen, when nation under God. So, anything else you want to bring out in here?
You know, the fact that it was not even supposed to
have a
yoke upon it, and it made me think, first of all, like the triple al, because it's not supposed to have, not supposed to raise an oak, yoke, I'm sorry, and it made me think of the fact that you can actually put a yoke under, and it can actually scrape the neck right there to the point where
it doesn't fit. Because Yeshua said, my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. What that meant was, if you put the right size and shaped yoke upon the animal that fits the animal, it's not overbearing that it's too tight or too loose. If it's too loose or too tight, it can put undue pressure or literally scrape his skin, and it will be difficult for him to finish his work. So Yeshua says, I never put any yoke on my students that's too hard for them. And I can say the same thing. I hope that I never put anything on my students that's too hard for them, because I know what they have in them. So I know what potential is in them. So therefore, I push them to their highest potential, but never push them to do anything they cannot bear.
Amen.
And that's what Yeshua does. He never puts any yoke upon us that we cannot bear, like the yoke of sin, but we should take on the yoke of heaven. And that yoke is easy, and that burden is light. The yoke for a rabbi was his teaching style. He would use a certain yoke to place on the students so that one day the student would teach just like him.
Yep.
And that's what Yeshua was saying to his disciples. You will do what I do, for greater works will you do.
Yep.
There's more of you. So if I duplicate myself 12 times over, guess what? There's more of me running around in the earth.
Yes.
Doing more work to fill the whole earth with the salvation knowledge of Yeshua.
Amen.
Did you just get a revelation?
Yes.
Isn't that great? All right, so may the blessings of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob be all on you wonderful Hebrew scholars now. All of you are scholars of the Torah. Amen?
Amen.
And guess what? Maybe you didn't receive or understand everything I said, but the Holy Spirit will bring it back to remembrance when needed. You'll be reading an article. You'll be watching a video. You'll be maybe watching us online in one of our services, and all of a sudden everything will come back. and you'll be reading a piece part of scripture, and something I said today will jump out at you from the old to the new, from the new back to the old. Amen?
Amen.
God bless all of you as you're seated today. Okay, we'll give them a hand clap. For being so brave to come up to the Torah today and become scholars. Now at this time, we're going to have our elders and leaders read a portion for each one of the portions of the Torah. How many have been enjoying the 6 days of manna?
Yes.
How many have found it helpful?
Thank you.
Have any of you shared it with friends and family?
Yes.
I encourage you, I make it a JPEG, a picture, that you can literally save it to any one of your electronic devices, and you can send it to friends or share the post on Facebook or wherever you go, because I believe this is a knowledge that the whole world should get. Amen.
Yes, amen.
I put it on my Facebook wall so that every pastor I know, every Christian I know, every Jew I know, they all read it. And guess what? They all send me back. Thank you. This is helpful.
Yes.
Even some of those that don't believe in Yeshua, and there's New Testament verses on there.
Yep.
I have a lady right now who's in great need of prayer. She visited Destiny Church once, and she says, I feel so much love, and I love the way you worship God here. Mm-hmm. And so here she meets a rabbi at a Christian church. She's going, this is interesting, but she just fell in love with all these other Jewish believers that she met that were a part of our Messianic ministry there. And every testimony she heard, she's been so open. Because she's at a breaking point, she was able to be receptive that Yeshua had some wisdom that she might want to learn from.
Right.
And so she is following everything I post, every video she's watching, and she's probably this close to just saying, Yeshua, you're the Messiah.
Amen.
She goes to Chabad. She goes to Temple I think Isaiah and Sinai in the desert. And so I'm just waiting for the day, just like many other Jews that have accepted Yeshua, I'm waiting for her to say, you know what, I'm ready.
Yep.
I'm finally ready. Tell me what I got to do. And you know what I'm probably going to say? Guess what? You're going to all carpool to the Simcha Yeshua and get the full dose of your Jewishness back and actually really see how we blend both worlds together. Amen.
Amen.
Are you glad that we have a Messianic congregation and a friend of Sinai? Share both the Jews and Gentiles, the revelation of Yeshua. To Gentiles that already know Yeshua as Jesus, guess what? They learn their Jewish roots. To Jews that don't know Yeshua or Jesus as their Yeshua, their Messiah, their Savior, we get to show them and introduce to them, maybe for the first time, their Messiah.
Amen.
Their Jewish Messiah. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So we're going to have our readers now.
I have a friend of a Spanish church who's actually translating our devotional to his leadership. And they're doing it every morning together as leaders.
Wow.
It's pretty cool.
It is.
Oh, I have another testimony. I have a Christian pastor who's connected to Pastor Abed in Destiny with the Passionate Pastors Ministry to, you know, they do the little conferences. The pastor called me up. He's Hispanic. He's in the Orange County area, actually Brea. And he says, I have a gentleman who's an elder of ours that wants to start a Messianic congregation. Will you mentor him?
Oh, wow.
So we've had our first conversation already, and I'm so excited that this Christian pastor is not saying you can't do that. He's saying, hey, I know just the person to introduce you to help mentor you in the process. Okay. And guess what? Probably in the Brea area, there's going to be a Messianic congregation rise up. I'll probably get it connected to the NJA and make sure that he has all the tools he needs. Even, so funny, I just got a call from Fairfax, from Solomon's bookstore, if you know anyone that needs a Torah scroll. I said, hold on, I might know somebody.
Right.
Can you imagine the day that they need to purchase a Torah scroll?
Right.
They're calling me and saying, Rabbi, I know you bought that other one from us. Hey, we have another one, very good price if you'd like. And so God just knows the open doors for anyone that wants to know the truth. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. It is God at work.
Amen. So we're in Parsha Chukat. We're going to start with Numbers 19, verses 1 through 5. We'll be reading out of the Complete Jewish Bible. It says, Adonai said to Moshe and Aharon, this is the regulation from the Torah which Adonai has commanded. Tell the people of Israel to bring you a young red female cow without fault or defect, which has never borne a yoke. You are to give it to Eleazar, the Kohen. It is to be brought outside the camp and slaughtered in front of him. Eleazar, the Kohen, is to take some of its blood with its finger and sprinkle this blood, toward the front of the tent of meeting 7 times. The heifer is to be burned to ashes before his eyes. The skin, meat, blood, and dung is to be burned to ashes.
Numbers 19, 6 through 10. The Kohens would take cedar wood, hyssop, scarlet yarn, fill them onto the heifer as it is burning up. Then the Kohen is to wash his clothes and himself in water. After which, he may re-enter the camp, but the Kohen will remain unclean until evening. The person who burned up the heifer is to wash his clothes and himself in water, but he will remain unclean until evening. A man who is clean is to collect the ashes of the heifer, store them outside the camp in a clean place. They are to be kept for the community of the people of Israel to prepare water for purification from sin. The one who collected the ashes of the heifer is to wash his clothes and be unclean until evening. For the people of Israel and for the foreigners staying with them, thus will be the permanent regulation.
Continuing in Numbers 20, 1 through 6, the people of Israel, the whole community, entered in the Zin Desert in the first month, and they stayed in Kadesh. There Miriam died, and there she was buried. Because the community had no water, they assembled themselves against Moshe and Aharon. The people quarreled with Moshe and said, "We wish we had died when our brothers died before Adonai. Why did you bring Adonai's community into this desert to die there? We and our livestock. Why did you make us leave Egypt to bring us to this terrible place without seed, figs, grapevines, pomegranates, or even water to drink?" Moshe and Aharon left the assembly, went to the entrance of the tent of meeting, and fell on their faces, and the glory of Adonai appeared to them. Continuing with Numbers 27 through 11. Adonai said to Moshe, "Take the staff, assemble the community, you and Aharon your brother, and before their eyes tell the rock to produce its water. You will bring them out of the rock and thus enable the community and the livestock to drink." Moshe took the staff from the presence of Adonai as he had ordered him. But after Moshe and Aharon had assembled the community in front of the rock, he said to them, "Listen here, you rebels. Are we supposed to bring you water from this rock?" Then Moshe raised his hand and he hit the rock twice with his staff. Water flowed out in abundance in the community, and their livestock drank.
Numbers 21, verses 1 through 3, and 31 through 22, 1. Then the king of Arad at Kananani, who lived in the Negev, heard that Israel was approaching by way of Atarim. So he attacked Israel and took some of them captive. Israel made a vow to Adonai, "If you will hand this people over to me, I will completely destroy their cities." Adonai listened to what Israel said and handed over the Kananami so that they completely destroyed them and their cities and named the place Hormah, complete destruction. Thus Israel lived in the land of Emori. Moshe sent men to reconnoiter Gazer. They captured his towns and drove out the Emori who were there. Then they turned and went up along a road to Bashan, and Og, the king of Bashan, marched out against them, he with all his people, to fight at Edrei. Adonai said to Moshe, "Don't be afraid of them, for I have handed them over to you, with all his people and his land. You will treat him just as you did Sihon, king of the Amori, who lived in Heshbon." So they struck him down with his sons and all his people until there was no one left alive, and they took control of his land. Then the people of Israel traveled on and camped in the plains of the Moab, beyond the Arden River, opposite Jericho. This is the word of the Lord.
Amen. You know, these readings, when you read it and you look at the
cow or the heifer that was taken for cleansing, for the water purification, the rabbis say the first thing you should think about is the golden calf.
Right.
And that this was an atonement for the golden calf. So whenever Israel was defiled by idols, there would be a purification process. And many times the animals represented the sin. For instance, bulls are for consecration for a large matter, but doves, pigeons are usually used for a smaller matter, a matter where there was innocence, or there was a fault, but there wasn't a gravity to it. And so you can see the greatest rebellion would be a goat, because of the characteristic of that goat and its stubbornness. Also the ram, which, you know, the ram is that one that's always trying to butt heads. And sometimes, you know, our sins are like rams, aren't they? But Yeshua was more like a lamb, wasn't he?
Yes.
A gentle lamb that will not even fight when you place the knife to its neck.
Right.
And so Yeshua did not fight his father, although he said, let this cup pass from me. He submitted to that will of the father to die, just like Isaac was willing to do with Abraham.
Amen.
But one of the things that stands out to me in all of this is simple obedience. Because Abraham simply obeyed God. Had Moses simply obeyed God with the striking of that rock twice and just spoke to the rock, the water would have come out like it did the first time he struck it at the beginning of their journey, in the beginning of the 40 years. But in the latter part of his life, now you want to disobey me? You've seen what disobedience does to everybody else. And it's just as important to start our ministry with obedience and our life with obedience, but to finish strong and end with obedience. What good is it to have all this success in ministry and then to end and fail? And I'm sure Moses wanted to go into the promised land because he felt a little bit like a failure. He watched his brother and sister both die. And now his life was going to soon close and come to an end. I see why he wanted to go at 120 years of age into the promised land.
Yeah.
He just didn't want to see his dream die.
Right.
He wanted to see his kids cross over.
Right.
He wanted to cross over with them.
Right.
I encourage you, if you're parents, don't let your dream die. See the vision of your kids crossing over even beyond you. Pass the baton to them and let them run the race the way they're supposed to.
Mm-hmm.
Don't baby them, because one day you won't be there to baby them.
Right.
Make sure you enable, empower them to do everything that you want them to do and see them doing even without you.
Right.
And as much as humanly possible they can live without you, let them.
Right.
Because it's like releasing that butterfly. When there's freedom, it can come back.
Yes.
And I think we have to be willing to release our kids, release those that we train into ministry, and allow them to do the things that they're called to do. And so I would say to all of us, let's not be like Moses in the stubborn moments, but let us be like Moses in the humble moments,
mm-hmm.
falling on his face, humbling himself before God, and even submitting to the will. No, you're not going to go into the promised land with him, but your son that you raised up, Joshua, he will take them into the land. Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Let's say the closing blessing for this Torah portion, as we also get our hearts prepared for the prophet reading and for the read out of shower, new covenant reading.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher natan lanu Torah emet v'chayei olam atah betocheinu. Baruch atah Adonai noten haTorah. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who gave us the Torah of truth and life everlasting, planted in our midst. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah. Amen.
The Hagba is the lifting of the Torah scroll, revealing three panels from the reading, declaring, this is the word of the Lord.
Bezot HaTorah Asher Sam Moshe Livnei Bnei Yisrael Al Pi Adonai Beyad Moshe.
And this is the Torah that Moses placed before the children of Israel at the command of the Lord by the hand of Moses.
Amen.
And as we redress the Torah scroll, you place back on the belt of truth, on the Torah of truth, just as we should wear as the armor of God, the belt of truth. We also adorn it like a bride and cover it with its mantle and breastplate, like a warrior and a high priest who wears the breastplate of righteousness.
Amen.
And let us today be adorned spotless before him. The only way to do that is study his perfect Torah. Because when we look into that perfect law of liberty, it shows us the error of our ways. That also reflects Yeshua, doesn't it? And gives us the way that we are transforming into his ways, that are higher than our ways, and his thoughts that are higher than our thoughts. Today we will place the Torah of truth back into its home, because when it's in our hearts, it brings shalom, and now we place it back into its home of the Ark, which is, for us, shalom in the home. Amen?
Amen.
So let's say, Etz Hayim, the tree of life, from the Proverbs.
Etz Hayim hi l'machazikim ba v'tom keha me'yushar v'racheha d'archei Noam v'chantivotecha shalom ashibenu Adonai elecha v'nashuba Chadesh, Chadesh Yameinu, Chadesh Yameinu, Keke.
It is a tree of life for those who take hold of it, and those who support it are praiseworthy. Its ways and ways of pleasantness and all of its paths are peace. Bring us back, O Lord, to you, and shall come in your days as of old. Amen.
At this time, we will hear from the prophet reading. For the portion of the prophets that correlates with this portion of Hukat. And we know the law and the prophets reveal Yeshua, as it was also part of the book of Acts, in the synagogue, their normal reading. Pages are so let's say the blessing together as we get ready to hear from Judges, the book of Shoftim, chapter 11, 1-33.
Baruch ata Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher bachar b'nevi'im tovim, v'rasa v'divrehem ha'nemarim be'emet. Baruch ata Adonai, habocher b'torah, למשה עבדו, לישראל עמו, מדי האמת בצדק. אמן.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has chosen the prophets, who is pleased with their words, that were uttered with truth. Blessed are you, O Lord, who chooses the Torah, Moses his servant, Israel his nation, and the prophets of truth and righteousness. Amen.
Amen.
One of the things that's kept the Jewish people is repetition. To continue to do the same things on a daily basis, on a weekly basis, we're doing what Yeshua did. So we prepare our hearts. Let's hear from Judges 11, starting with verse 1. And this is from the Art Scroll Chumash version. Your version might read a little differently. Jephthah the Gileadite was a mighty man of valor. And he was the son of a concubine, and Gilead begot Jephthah. And Gilead's wife bore him sons, and his wife's sons grew up. And when his wife's sons grew up, they drove Jephthah away and said to him, "You shall not inherit in our father's house, for you are the son of another woman." So Jephthah fled because of his brothers and settled in the land of Tob. Empty-handed men gathered themselves against Jephthah and ventured forth with him. After a period of time, the children of Ammon, or the Ammonites, made war with Israel. And it happened that when the children of Ammon made war with Israel, that the Gileadite elders went to fetch Jephthah and the land from the land of Tob. They said to Jephthah, "Go forth and become our chief, and we will do battle with the children of Ammon." But Jephthah said to the Gileadite elders, "Was it not you who hated me and who drove me away from my father's house? So why have you come to me now when you are in distress?" The Gileadite elders said to Jephthah, "For this have we now returned to you, that you go with us, and we will do battle with the children of Ammon, and that you shall become a leader unto us, all of the inhabitants of Gilead." So Jephthah said to the Gileadite elders, "If you return to me and do battle with the children of Ammon, and the Lord delivers them before me, I will become your leader." The Gileadite elders said to Jephthah, "The Lord shall witness between us if it is not according to your word that we do.
So Jephthah went to the Gileadite elders, and the people set him as a leader and a chief over them. And Jephthah spoke all his words before the Lord in Mizpah. Jephthah sent emissaries to the king of the children of Ammon, saying, "What is unto you and unto me that you have come to me to make war in my land?" The king of the children of Ammon, or the Ammonites, said to Jephthah's emissaries, "Because Israel took my land when it ascended from Egypt, and Arnon like the Jabbok until the Jordan River. So now return them in peace." And Jephthah once again sent emissaries to the king of the children of Ammon. And he said to him, "Thus said Jephthah, Israel did not take the land of Moab and the land of the children of Ammon. For when Israel ascended from Egypt, Israel went in the wilderness unto the Sea of Reeds, or you know as the Red Sea, and they arrived at Kadesh. Israel sent emissaries to the king of Edom, or the Edomites, saying, 'Let me please pass through your land.' But the king of Edom didn't listen. And also to the king of Moab did Israel send, but he was also not willing. So Israel sojourned in Kadesh. It went through the wilderness and went around the land of Edom and the land of Moab and came to the eastern side of the land of Moab where they encamped across from Arnon. But they did not enter the border of Moab, for Arnon is the border of Moab. Then Israel sent emissaries to Sihon, the king of the Amorites, king of Heshbon. And Israel said to him, 'Let us please pass through your land into my place.' But Sihon did not trust Israel to pass through his border." Sounds like border issues today. "Rather, Sihon assembled all the people, all his people, and they encamped in Yahaz. And he made war against Israel. Then the Lord, the God of Israel, delivered Sihon and all of his people in the hand of Israel, and he struck them. And Israel took possession of the entire land of the Amorites, the inhabitant of that land. They took possession of the entire border of Amorite from Arnon to Jabbok and from the wilderness to the Jordan. And now the Lord, the God of Israel, has driven out the Amorite before the people of Israel, and you would possess it. Do you not take into your possession that which your God, Chemosh, bequeaths to you? That may you possess. But all the Lord our God drives out from before us, we shall take possession of it. And now are we much better than Balak, the son of Zippor, the king of Moab? Did he ever strive against Israel? Did he ever do battle with them? When Israel dwelled in Heshbon and its villages and the Aroer, or Aroer, and the villages and in all of the cities that are alongside the Arnon for 300 years, why did you recover them during that time? I have not sinned against you, but you do me wrong to make war against me. May the Lord, the judge today between the children of Israel and the children of the Ammonites." But the king of the children of Ammon did not listen to the words of Jephthah that he had sent to him. The Spirit of the Lord was upon Jephthah. He passed through Gilead and through Manasseh, and he passed through Mizpah of Gilead, and Mizpah of Gilead he passed through to the children of Ammon. And Jephthah declared a vow unto the Lord, and he said, "If you will indeed deliver the children of Ammon into my hand, then it will be that whatever emerges, what will emerge from the doors of my house to greet me when I return in peace from the children of Ammon, it shall be unto the Lord, and I will offer it as a burnt offering." And Jephthah passed through the children of Ammon to do battle against them, and the Lord delivered them into his hand. And he struck them from Aroer until you come to Minit, 20 cities, unto the plains of Chermim. And a very great slaughter, the children of Ammon were subdued before the children of Israel.
Amen.
Wow. The very one that was rejected was chosen as king and was anointed to defeat the enemy. Does it sound familiar?
Yes.
The very one, Yeshua, who was rejected, was chosen to be king, and was anointed to defeat the enemy. And so today, the Son of God was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. Aren't you glad that Yeshua the Messiah, though he was rejected, he is anointed as King, and he has defeated our enemies just like Jephthah. We absolutely know that God is on our side, amen?
Amen.
And God is fighting for us. Yes. He's pushing back the darkness, isn't he? Yep. And even now in Israel, we pray the Lord push back the forces of darkness against those forces that are coming against Israel.
Yeah.
And God will bless his children, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob again.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Let's say the blessing for this prophet reading. Let's thank God for the victory that God has given our people.
Amen.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam sur kol ha'olamim tzadik b'chol ha'arot ha'el ha'neiman ha'omer ve'oseh ha'mdaber u'mkayem shechol devarav emet v'tzedek ne'amah atahu Adonai Eloheinu v'nevarim devarecha v'devar echad midvarecha achor lo yushurekam ki ha'melech ne'iman barak amalata baruch atah Adonai ha'el ha'neiman b'chol devarav amen. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, Rock of all eternities, righteous in all generations, the trustworthy God, who says and does, who speaks and fulfills, all of whose words are true and righteous. Trustworthy are you, O Lord our God, and trustworthy are your words. Not one of your words is turned back to its origin unfulfilled, for you are God, trustworthy and compassionate King. Blessed are you, O Lord, God, who is trustworthy in all his words. Amen. Have mercy on Zion, for it's the source of our life. To the one who is deeply humbled, bring salvation sweetly in our days. Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, who gladdens Zion, who are children. Amen. Gladness, O Lord, our God, with Elijah, the prophet, your servant, with the kingdom of the house of David, your anointed Messiah. May he come speedily and cause our heart to exult. On his throne, let no stranger sit, nor let others continue to inherit his honor. For by your holy name, you swore to him that his lamp would not be extinguished forever and ever. Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, shield of David, Magen David. Amen. Al HaTorah, Al Vodah, Al HaNevim, Al Yom HaShabbat HaZeh, Shenatata Lanu Adonai Eloheinu, Likdusha V'Limnucha, Lechavod U'Letifaret. Al HaKol Adonai Eloheinu, Anaknu Modim Lach, U'Rachim Otah, Yitbarach Shemcha V'Fi Kol Hay, Tamid Le'olam Va'ed, Baruch atah Adonai, Mekadesh HaShabbat. Amen. For the Torah reading, for the prayer service, for the reading from the prophets, for this Sabbath day, that you, O Lord, our God, have given us, for holiness and contentment, for glory and splendor. For all this, O Lord, our God, we gratefully thank you and bless you. May your name be blessed by the mouth of all the living always, for all eternity. Blessed are you, O Lord, who sanctifies the Sabbath.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And as our reading shall be returned at this time, we'll have our final reading for some announcements in worship. And we'll read the Brit HaShah and say the blessing at this time. Boker Tov, Leah.
Boker Tov.
Let's say the blessing together. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, Hashem atah Mashiach Yeshua, by the reign of the Brit HaShah. Baruch atah Adonai, Notein HaBrit HaShah. Amen.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the sign, shield, and the Lord's new covenant. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the new covenant. Amen.
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom. Today's portion is John 3:10-21. Yeshua answered him, "You hold the office of teacher in Israel, and you don't know this? Yes, indeed, I tell you that. What we speak about, we know, and what we give evidence of, we have seen, but you people don't accept our evidence. If you people don't believe me when I tell you about the things of the world, how will you believe me when I tell you about the things of heaven? No one has gone up into heaven. There is only the one who has come down from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moshe lifted up the serpent in the desert, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that everyone who trusts in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only and unique Son, so that everyone who trusts in him may have eternal life, instead of being utterly destroyed. For God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but rather so that through him the world might be saved. Those who trust in him are not judged. Those who do not trust have been judged already, in that they have not trusted in the one who is God's only and unique Son. Now this is the judgment. The light has come into the world, but people love the darkness rather than the light. Why? Because their actions were wicked. For everyone who does evil things hates the light and avoids it, so that his actions won't be exposed. But everyone who does what is true comes to the light, so that all may see that his actions are accomplished through God. That is the word of the Lord.
Amen.
You know, I just saw a couple of verses that I just like, and it's going to tie into the message today. I love what it says. You finish with what verse?
21.
I want to read 22 and 23. After this, Yeshua and his Talmudim went out into the countryside of Yehuda, which is Judah, or Judea, where he stayed a while with them and immersed people. Yohanan, too, was immersing at Enaim, near Shalem, or Salem. It says, because there was plenty of water there, and people kept coming to be immersed. This was before Yohanan's imprisonment. I love the fact that Yeshua said, come unto me. Yeah. Basically, the living water, the source of it comes from the Father, through the Son, and by the way of the Holy Spirit, the living water comes to us. And that same living water would cleanse the priests in our Torah portion. The same living water would come out of a rock. The same living water could cleanse those that were defiled by death. And that same living water, people were immersed in, their life was made acceptable unto God. Aren't you grateful for the living water of the Holy Spirit? Yes. The water of his word that washes us. The water of the Torah that gives us that foundation and that first drink. And that water of Yeshua that comes through the way of the Holy Spirit. And we're thankful today that that's the same water that brings life in a desert. That Yeshua was a light in their dark places, like a fire by night and a cloud by day. But there was also that serpent that was lifted up. All these symbols that we can see in Yeshua, all found in the wilderness, getting us to the promised land. Amen. Amen. So that all the promises in Yeshua are what? Yes and amen. Let's say the closing blessing. Thanking God for these words of truth today. Baruch Ata Adonai, Eloheinu Melech Haolam, Asher Atamanu Kibrei Emet, Lechaye Olam Ata Betocheinu, Baruch Ata Adonai, Noteinu Lamrida Hashah, Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who gave us the words of truth and life everlasting, planted in our midst. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the new covenant. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord.
The shofars over them as the scripture commands to use the ram's horn for. So as the ushers bring a tzedakah box up front, if you haven't already prepared your tithe and your offering, we're going to give you a chance now to bring it before the Lord and place it in the tzedakah box. Our tzedakah box is usually placed at the entrances in our synagogue. There's a special one for Oneg, usually in the fellowship hall, but the ones with these two doorways are for your tithes and your offerings. It's good written. So, if you'd like to come at this time, bring your offering and place it in the tzedakah box. Usually in a Jewish synagogue, they don't pass the plate, but we allow people to give freely, the way we should all give, amen?
Amen.
After the sound of the shofar and the closing prayer, we'll bless our children. So, mothers, prepare to bring your sons and your daughters into the circle of prayer after we remove the tzedakah box. And the men will surround you with the tallit, creating a hedge of protection so that we can bless our children in this way and pray safety over our families. How many know we live in a day where we need more safety? A lot of violence in the land, a lot of anti-Semitism, a lot of pain and suffering, even hatred among the races and the nations. And you know what? We know when Yeshua comes, he will bring peace. Until then, we pray for the Prince of Peace to give us peace in our hearts. Amen.
Amen.
Just hold on to it.
So let's stand today in honor of the Lord. You want to stretch your hands toward this offering today and towards heaven. Let's believe God for a blessing over this month of this new month of the, which is the month of Tammuz, which is correlates to our July, but our June and July. But we're going to pray a blessing all month. Amen. I may have seen the wonderful work that's gone on in our fellowship hall and in our Hebrew classroom. It's going to continue on into the kitchen and serving area. And God is just blessing our congregation to grow, to expand, and to see fresh things happen. So let's pray. Avinu Malkeinu, our Father and our King, we bless you with the sound of the shofar over our offerings, and thank you for the provision. We now bless you in the Hebrew tongue. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, Sher kitchanu b'mitzvota, b'tzivanu lishmoa kol ha-shofar. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with your commandments and has commanded us to hear the sound of the shofar. Our Father, our King, we thank you and bless you that as we hear the sound of the shofar, we know it's a sound of victory in the camp of your people. Father, when Israel would hear the shofar, they knew it was time to march forward with great advancement, to know that God, you were on their side and you would defeat all of their enemies as long as they were faithful and obedient. They would enter the promised land and eat the fat of the land. Father, let us experience the fat and the abundance of the land that you have promised soon one day to be in the very land of Israel, in the streets of Jerusalem, in the new Jerusalem. Until that day, we keep marching, we keep moving forward, we keep hearing the sound of the shofar, Shabbat after Shabbat. And Father, we're preparing for the soon sound of the voice of the archangel Michael and Yeshua's return, Lord God, with the sound of a shofar, the sound of a ram's horn, the sound of a trumpet, Lord God, declaring Messiah's total victory, that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and the kingdoms of this world shall become the kingdoms of our God and of his Messiah. Today we declare these offerings to you. Use them as you see fit for your kingdom and for your glory. And we pray every seed sown will be pressed down, shaken together, and running over, that men will give back to our bosom so that we can be channels of blessing like Abraham, like Isaac, and Jacob. These tithes and offerings we offer to you, and we bless your name, B'Shem Yeshua. Amen. This time, let's gather the children. Come in the center of our prayer today, and any man that has a tallit, create a hedge of protection around our moms, our mothers, and their children, the men of the congregation. So we're going to create a hedge of protection through the circle of the prayer shawl. So everybody come into the center. Ron, why don't you come over here? Ron's new to the congregation, we're going to come under the shadow of our wings. Amen. Yes. Psalms 91 says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. And that means you got to get a prayer shawl soon. Yeah, that's next. Today. Yes, he said today. He just wanted to not only learn at the Bible college, he wanted to be a student. And guess what? Summer break. But guess what? In the synagogue, on Shabbat, there's no break. Amen. We continue becoming students, Talmidim of Yeshua. Avinu Malkeinu, our Father and our King, we thank you for Psalms 91, that we dwell in the secret place of the Most High, the shadow of the Almighty. Today, under your feathers, we trust, and the tassels, corners of our garments represent wings of your presence resting over our lives. Save us and we shall be saved. Heal us and we shall be healed today in the name of Yeshua. We pray you'd bless our boys like Ephraim and Manasseh. We pray our girls would be blessed like Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, and Leah. That the blessings of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob would be upon us all. You would bless and keep us, shine your face upon us, be gracious to us, lift up your countenance upon us, and illuminate us with all of your favor. Father, we thank you, Lord God, that you will establish peace for us, our children, and our children's children. For your namesake in love, Father. B'shem Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. God bless all of you. Shabbat shalom, everyone.
Shabbat shalom.
Good to be in the house of the Lord today?
Yes.
All right. How many of you enjoying their devotionals?
Yes.
Good, good, good. We're getting ready to get into a message today. And we are in the portion called Hukat. So we're excited to look at a message called A Broken Cistern Leads to a Thirsty Soul. Can you say that with me?
A broken cistern leads to a thirsty soul.
Say it again. A broken cistern leads to a thirsty soul. We are in Parshat Hukat, which is equal to Bamidbar or the book of Numbers. Guess what? Can you run that back there? We don't have Patricia today. She does all these things. Can you change a slide, please? Just drop it down with the arrow. No, just click the arrow down.
Happy anniversary, Patricia.
There we go. Yeah, she's on her anniversary. So I'm going to kind of restart this portion so we can edit that. All right, so we're looking at Parshat Hukat, which is Bamidbar, or Numbers 19, 1 through 22, 1. And also Shoftim, Judges 11, 1 through 33. And then we had Yochanan, or John, 3:10-21.
Amen.
We want to say Baruchim Habaim, welcome to all of our first time guests. We're glad you're here today. How many ready for their 10 minutes of Torah?
Yes!
Right. Let's get ready to see 10 minutes of Torah today, our Mosaic instruction. It says in 19:1, it says, Adonai said to Moshe and Aharon, this is the regulation, or in Hebrew, Chukat. Can you try that?
Chukat.
Or the Hukat from the Torah. It's a divine regulation or divine decree from the Torah, which Adonai has commanded. Tell the people of Israel to bring a young red female cow, or a red what?
Heifer.
Without fault or defect, which has never borne a yoke. It has to be free from a yoke. So it reminds me of Yeshua, the only one born without a yoke of sin. Amen?
Amen.
And chapter 19 verse 5 says, the heifer is to be burned to ashes before his eyes. Its skin, meat, blood, and dung is to be burned to ashes. The kohen, which is the priest, is to take cedar wood, what else? Hyssop, and scarlet what?
Yarn.
What a weird mix, right?
Yep.
Say it with me. Cedar wood, hyssop, and scarlet yarn. It's funny because the cedar wood reminds me of the cross. And the hyssop reminds me of what was used not only to put blood on the doorpost, which is like wood again, like the cross, but also when Yeshua was thirsty. And then the scarlet yarn makes me think of his blood. So these elements remind us of Yeshua's sacrificial death. In fact, it says they are to all burn up. And in verse number 6, it says, the Kohen is to take the cedar wood, hyssop, and scarlet yarn and throw them onto the heifer as it's burning up. A man who is clean is to collect the ashes of the heifer and store them outside the camp in a clean place. They are to be kept for the community of Israel to prepare for the purification of sin. So on your devotional, I gave you the concept of cleansing. I gave you David's form of cleansing. We sang about today in Psalms 51, 1 through 12. Remember, David said, create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit within me. Cleansing is purification from what?
Sin.
Impurities. Impurities. So it's not just really sin. It's impurities. If someone touches the dead, you become impure. It doesn't mean you've sinned, per se, but you've touched something that died. We also gave you Ezekiel 36, 24 through 29, that gives us a new heart, a new spirit, and washes us from our filthy impurities. The prophet told us spiritually on the inside. So this ceremony was on the outside, but it reflected what goes on in the what? The inside. God doesn't want to just clean our bodies. He wants to clean our hearts, our soul, our mind and emotions and will. And I love Hebrews 9, 8 through 14. I hope you got a chance to read that one. It is the only other place that red heifer is ever mentioned. It's in the book of Hebrews. Aren't you glad that as Messianic believers, that the New Testament actually expounds upon, records, and remembers the Torah and never forgets it?
Amen. Yes.
Very hard to find any information on the red heifer, but you actually find it related to Messiah's sacrificial death in Hebrews chapter 9. So if we keep going and look at the portion in verse 18, a clean person will take a bunch of hyssop leaves, dip it in the water, sprinkle the tent. Look what it says. The person who touched the bone of the person killed or who died naturally or the grave. So again, the person that is going to be cleansed has possibly been the person who's touched the dead person or someone that has died. Bless you. Verse 19 goes on to say, the clean person will sprinkle the unclean person on the third and sixth, seventh days, and the seventh day he will purify him, and he will wash his what?
Clothes
and what else?
Himself
in water, and he'll be clean at evening. This process is seen as the cleansing of what Jews use in the mikveh, or the mikvah, and this is an immersion pool that you wash your body in pure water. Baptism, baptismos in the Greek, comes from this priestly ritual of the priest washing his body. It's recorded also in Hebrews chapter 9 that there was various washings the priest would do. The Greek there in the text in Hebrews chapter 9 is baptismos, where we get the word baptism in English. So really, baptism goes back to the Jewish priesthood. It actually goes back to Israel, who washed themselves before Mount Sinai, before the giving of the Ten Commandments. So what we learn from this is what we see in, actually, verse number 1 of chapter 20, that water is essential. Because if you take a look at the death of Miriam, water, or lack of it, is connected to Miriam. Remember who Miriam was? When the water went up on either side of them in the Sea of Reeds, you know it as the Red Sea, and they walked on dry ground, Miriam was dancing. When the horse and the rider were drowned into the what? Into the sea. Just like your sins are cast into the sea of forgetfulness, and you know that you've been washed clean of your sin. So water is essential not only to wash, but to what?
Drink.
Drink. They had no water. And how many knows know that when the children of Israel have no water, they start kvetching?
Yeah.
They start complaining. Look what it says in chapter 8. Moses was told the people want water. Well, guess what? Tell the rock or speak to the rock and it will produce what?
Water.
And you will bring them water out of the rock. You will do what? You will bring them water out of the rock. What did Adonai say? You will bring them water out of the rock. Is that a clear instruction?
Yes.
Yes. So why is it that verse 9 says that Moses took the staff from the presence of Adonai as he had ordered him? But it says that, but after Moshe and Aharon had assembled the community, what happened? No, he got mad first.
Right.
Every time something goes wrong, it always stems to Moses' anger, right?
Right.
Yeah. He says, listen here, you rebels. Are we supposed to bring you water from this rock?
Right.
But wait a minute, didn't God already tell you to bring water from the rock?
Right. Yeah. Right.
So who are you mad at? The people or God?
Right.
God saw this as disrespect. You see, sometimes we get mad at people because we have to take care of them. Well, I have to keep take care of these people? Well, if God told you to take care of them, then take care of them.
Right.
Why complain about children that you wanted to raise?
Right.
You wanted them from God, now God says take care of them.
Right. Right.
You don't yell at your kid, you want me to keep taking care of you? Grow up!
Yeah.
And the kid's like 6 months. I mean, you know, it doesn't work that way, right? Look what happened. He struck the rock twice instead of speaking to it, and water flowed in abundance. Now, here's the beauty of this. Water needs to flow in abundance in our life, but we don't need to strike the rock. We just need to speak to it.
Right.
How many know the rock is a picture of Messiah?
Yes.
In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, yes. 1 through 5? Messiah is the symbolic in that rock that followed them, the rabbi said, in the wilderness that gave them water.
Right.
When Miriam died, the water stopped, so they started complaining. And it's funny, when you think about the rock, it was only struck once. The beginning of 40 years, it was not to be struck again. So we see thirst was the next most important thing. And I gave you many verses on studying for dealing with the thirst in your life. Because thirst is a signal for what? Water. Thirst is a signal for water. How many know if you get thirsty, it's a sign of dehydration?
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you know the moment you get thirsty, you're already dehydrated?
Yeah. Yeah.
If you can actually say, I'm thirsty, you're dehydrated. It's your body's way of saying, hey, what's going on? You haven't given us water lately. You see, the thirst for water takes us to a Hebrew word, makor, which is a fountain, properly something dug, generally a source of water, even naturally flowing, figuratively of happiness, wisdom, progeny, meaning your kids, and it's translated fountain, issue, spring, or wellspring. How many know out of your heart flows the issues of life? Yes. So therefore, out of your heart flows the rivers of life.
Yes. Yes.
Or living water. It's another word I gave you. Now, this is my 10 minutes of Torah. How many are ready for 10 minutes of the prophets?
Yes.
All right. So we walk away from Moses realizing water is good for cleansing, but water is also good for drinking, and we need both. We need to cleanse the outside, but we need to drink in water for the inside. Amen?
Amen.
So if we look at our prophet reading, I'm not going to look at the one that I asked you to study for the Shabbat, but I'm actually going to go to Jeremiah chapter 2 because it goes along with this thirst concept. Jeremiah 2:13. It says, for my people have committed two evils. How many evils?
Two.
Number one, they've abandoned me, the fountain of living water. See, all problems start when you abandon God. He said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. But you leave him, that's when you're going to get thirsty. So your first number one problem in every situation is you leave God. Because God has promised he'll never leave you. How many realize in situations that were the worst in your life, it was you that left him first?
Yes.
If a sheep wanders off, he's going to get thirsty because he has no shepherd to give him water, lead him by the still waters, right, to restore his soul. And if he gets hungry, it's his fault because he can't be led by a shepherd by the green pastures. But the loving shepherd goes anyway to get the lost sheep. He'll leave 99 good ones and smart ones and go after that one bad sheep that wandered off and is now thirsty and hungry. I love what it says. That's the first thing you did. But here's the second problem. Then we try to fix our problem and do it ourselves. You dug for yourself cisterns that became broken cisterns that can't hold any water. And remember what we said for the title? A broken cistern leads to a thirsty soul. So if you have a broken cistern, whose fault is it? Now this is what you don't know about a cistern. A cistern is a man-made reservoir of water. Mm-hmm. It's taking something natural and creating something extra. They would even take these natural holes or dig a hole in the ground, dry, it could be a prison, but with water in it, rainwater, it could be used as a reservoir. And they would have to seal it with either a rock, and they would usually put limestone all around it to make sure that the water didn't get in, and they could literally mold the shape of the vessel they want it to be. And in times of drought, they could go to the water source.
Right.
Sad thing about the heat of the desert in a drought, the limestone could crack, causing the whole vessel or entrance to crack. And if your cistern is broken, the water will leak.
Right.
If your marriage is like a cistern, if it's broken, it will leak.
Right.
If you're like a woman with an issue of blood, you leak. If your children are broken, they will leak. You should expect people that are thirsty in your life to have a leaking problem. Because their cistern has been broken. What is broken in your life that is leaking out the living water that God has put inside you? It's not that you're not getting filled up, it's that you keep leaking. Something's broken. I love what Jeremiah goes on to say in chapter 17. In verse 7 he says, blessed is the man who trusts in Adonai. Adonai will be his what?
Security.
He will be like a what?
Tree
planted near water. It spreads out its roots by the what?
River,
which is the water source. It does not notice when heat comes, and foliage, the leaf, is luxuriant. We know in the New Jerusalem, the leaf will never wither because the leaf will be healing for the nations. Do you know where we get our medicine from?
Leaves.
Leaves, herbs,
plants. We take the extract and we make medicine. You know the old medicine man?
Yeah.
Where do you think he got that from? He came from the Bible.
Right.
The leaves will be healing for the nations. The leaf or the foliage will be luxuriant, and it will not be anxious in the year of drought. You know where anxiety comes from? You've been dry lately. So you start wondering, where's your source? You start wondering, where's the money going to come from? Where's the food going to come from? Where's the supply for my business going to come? Where's the love in my marriage going to come from? You've been feeling dry because something's broken. And unless you're willing to fix it, it's going to keep leaking. And therefore, you get so dry, in drought, your leaves wither. That means everyone begins to notice your tree is drying up. Your marriage is drying up. Your children are drying up. Your finances are drying up. You see, it starts on the inside, and then the tree begins to show on the what?
Outside.
Why can't we see the signs of the seasons?
True.
Right? Winter, spring, summer, or fall. All you gotta do is call. Cause you he'll be there, right? You guys don't want to sing the song. Come on. I need Pete here to play the guitar. Look at the problem. It says the reason is the heart is more deceitful than anything else and morally sick. Who can fathom it? You see, a heart that's not firmly fixed in the Lord, who doesn't put his trust in the Lord, is a heart that will experience drought. Do you know what causes drought? Doubt. Drought is caused by doubt. Because faith creates a flow of living water that keeps on flowing. A land flowing with milk and honey. Doubt causes drought. So, if we take a look at Jeremiah 17:10, it says, Adonai searches the heart. He tests the inner motivations. Watch this. In order to give everyone what his actions and conduct deserve. Do you know that you get what you deserve? I hate to think of that. But we actually get what we deserve. What does that say if God gave us even in our life? You deserve it. Not because you're worthy, but he made you worthy.
Right.
He washed you clean of your sin. Therefore, you are now worthy to receive. You know what the blood of the covenant does in Hebrews chapter 2? The blood of the covenant makes you and I worthy of salvation. But what if you trample underfoot the Spirit of grace and do despite to him? Spite him. Reject him. Reject the living water. The Bible says you were considered worthy by the blood of the covenant. Why would you now start rejecting the work of the Holy Spirit in your life? It makes you feel unworthy again. If you have an unworthy problem, you probably have a heart problem. There's either a block of the water or something has a leak and it's been drying up. Look what it says in verse 13. I love this. Tikvat Yisrael. How many know what the tikva is? The national anthem of Israel. It's the hope of Israel. It says, hope of Israel, which is the Lord, Adonai. All who abandon you will be ashamed. Those who leave you will be inscribed in the dust. Dry, dust, death. Because they have abandoned Adonai. Watch this. He's the what?
Source.
The source of living water. And look what Jeremiah says. Heal me, O Lord, and I will be what?
Healed.
Save me, O Lord, and I will be what?
Saved.
I love that. God says he will save us. I love what Isaiah 55:1 says. All who are thirsty, come to the water. You without money, come buy and eat. Yes, come. Notice come once. Now come twice. Buy wine and milk without money. It's free, like salvation. Why spend money for what isn't food? Your wages for what doesn't satisfy. Watch this. Listen carefully to who? To me. Now this is Isaiah talking, but I don't think Isaiah's saying come to me. Right? He's the voice of God. And you will eat well, and you will enjoy the fat of the land. Open your ears, and what?
Come to me.
Notice three times. Come to me, come to me, come to me. Is there a fourth one? Okay, come to the water. Oh yeah, first you have to come to the water. Yes, then he says, just come. Then he says, come to me. Right? And each time he says, come, he says, listen. Listen well, and you will live. I will make the everlasting covenant with you. The grace, I assure David, the sure mercies of David, is the messianic hope. That is the promise to David that there will always be a son sitting on your throne. So who's the source of living water? Well, actually, the Father is. The Father is the source. Yeshua is the one that gives us the living water. But the water he gives us is the Spirit of God.
Because God is the source, His Spirit is the actual flow of water, but it comes through Yeshua. Everything's done in the name of Yeshua, through Yeshua. He gives us living water. He's not the living water, He gives it. He's the one that quenches our thirst by giving us the cup of water. Okay? Look what it says in Psalms 36:8. David said this, they are abundantly satisfied with the fullness of your house, and you give them drink from the rivers of your what?
Pleasures.
Or literally delights. For with you is the what? Fountain of life. In your life, we see light. Save us and we shall be saved. Heal us and we shall be healed. Show us your light and we'll see light. Give us water and we'll thirst no more. You see the picture? The first thing we do wrong is we abandon God, the source of water. The second thing we do is we create our own source of water called a cistern. Eventually it's going to break. Because if we have doubt that leads to drought, and we don't trust in the Lord, which leads to the living water or the river, we're going to dry up. Eventually you can only do it so long yourself. Amen?
Yes.
I'm getting a few people looking at me like, you sure, Rabbi?
Yeah, yeah. Sure.
Look at Nehemiah 9:15. Look what it says. You gave them bread from heaven for their what?
Hunger.
And you also brought water out of the rock. For what?
Their thirst.
Look at verse 20. You also gave them your what?
Spirit
to instruct them. Look at this latter part of verse 20. Everybody look at this. And did not withhold your manna from their mouth and gave them water for their thirst. Do you know if God is the source, He's the one we go to for it? That's why David said in Psalm 68:26, bless God in the congregation, the Lord from the fountain of Israel. Don't you understand that God is the fountain of Israel?
Amen.
He's the source of water. Solomon said it this way, the law, the Torah of the wise is the fountain of life. How many know his Torah is also living water?
Yes.
The rabbis have always taught us the Torah is like water. We need to drink it.
Amen.
And it's sweet and not bitter. So how many ready for 10 minutes of the Read How to Shop? We've got 10 minutes of the Torah, and it wasn't too extensive. 10 minutes of the prophets, and now we're ready for 10 minutes of the apostolic writings as we look at the Gospel of John. We read John 3 today that talked about Yeshua being likened to the serpent that was lifted up. And we saw that immersion in living water was one of the processes in chapter 3. But look at this experience with a woman at a well in Samaria or Shomron. Yochanan 4:7 says, a woman from Shomron, which is Samaria, came to draw some what?
Water.
Yeshua said to her, give me a drink of what?
Water.
His Talmudim had gone into the town to buy food. The woman was from Shomron and said to him, how is it that you, a Jew, ask for water from me, a woman of Shomron? For Jews did not associate with people of Shomron or Samaria. Doesn't it sound like some of the conflict that happens today between Jews and Palestinians?
Yes.
Israelis and Palestinians?
Yep.
Or Jews and Gentiles? Or Jews and Arabs? The same kind of argument is going on all over a fight for water.
Yes.
But trust me, everybody's thirsty. What are we fighting for? Why don't we help each other get the water out of the well?
Right. Yes.
Don't fight with the Jew.
Right.
The Jew owns the land, so ask the Jew for water. And guess what? The Jew's going to give you water.
Right.
Because Jews are taught hospitality.
Right.
I posted that this week, too. How many know Jews, like Abraham,
were
the originators of the concept of hospitality? Let's take a look at verse 10. I love what it says. If you knew the gift of God and who it was saying to you, give me a drink of water, you would have asked, and He would have given you living water. How many know it's simply asking? Why do we have to fight each other? Why don't we just ask for what we would like? And here's the thing, when it comes to politics, why don't you be honest with what you really want?
Yes.
You say one thing and do another, politician, guess what? Be honest. Tell the people what you really intend to do. And that goes from the top all the way to the bottom. From the bottom back to the top. We need to ask. If we're lacking something, the Bible says, ask and you shall
receive.
Seek and you shall find, knock and the door will be open unto you. Look what the problem was. In verse 11, she said to him, sir, you don't have a bucket. And the well is deep. See, when they would make a cistern or a well, not only would they put a rock to guard the well, but somebody would have to take the rock off and they'd have to take a rope and lower a bucket down and get the water and let it go deep enough
to get not the surface water that could be murky, but the deep water, because the water that is deep is pure. Amen. Sometimes we haven't gone deep enough. Yep. There's some junk on the surface. If we go a little deeper, we'll get to the source. Oh man, you're not giving me an amen today. Amen. Now, take a look at the conclusion of this. He tells this woman, don't you know this water is going to be inside you in verse 14? A well of water springing up into everlasting life. In other words, I'm not really talking to you about just water. Because he says, everyone that thirsts from this water, or drinks from this water, they will thirst again. But whoever drinks from the water I'm going to give them will never thirst. Verse 13, Yeshua answered, everyone who drinks from this water will get thirsty again. See, the problem with water is, how many have ever been thirsty for water and had a sip of water? How many know that just opens up your thirst?
Yes.
It's like the one bite of food. You know when they give you an appetizer? Don't you know the restaurant is being strategic?
Yep.
They know they're going to give you some bread. They're even going to give you some olive oil, some vinegar, maybe a little salt to pour on that. And you start dipping that bread in there and you get that salt to your mouth, the salt creates a thirst.
Yes, it does.
And they know that. So they know you're going to order a lot of food. Look at verse 15. Yes, sir. Give me this water, the woman said, so that I won't have to be thirsty and keep coming to draw water. And I can quit this job. He said to her, go call your husband.
Wow.
And come back. And she answered, I don't have a husband. Yeshua said, you're right, you don't have a husband. How many know Yeshua doesn't ask a question that he doesn't already have the answer for? Good leaders always research the answer before they ask their team and their students the question. Because if you ask a question, you better have the answer yourself. You just want to see if they got the answer. So always remember that, students. If I ask a question, I probably already have the answer for it. I'm just waiting to see if you get the same answer. Watch this. It says in verse 17, the end of it, you're right, you don't have a husband. Here's the problem. Proverbs 15:5 says this. Drink the water from your own what?
Cistern.
Fresh water from your own well. Let what your springs produce be dispersed outside, streams of flowing water in the streets. But let them be for you alone and not for strangers with you.
Amen.
What is he talking about? Is he talking about water anymore? Look at verse 18. Let your fountain, the wife of your youth, be blessed. Find joy in her. That will preach the horns off of Billy Goat. Men, not only is God your source of living water through Yeshua by the Spirit, but next, when you find a wife, you find a good thing. You have found a cistern and a well of water that will shower you with blessings for the rest of your life. Find joy in her. Don't look for joy anywhere else. Your water might produce wonderful stuff in the marketplace, but it will never produce the joy you'll get at home. Don't let your joy come from out there, your job, your business. Not even the accolades your children get when you say, oh yeah, those are my kids. See, when they do good, they're your kids. When they do bad, they're her kids. No, it's universal. It is. It's universal. But the promise is to you that your wife will be your fountain. I like this one. Take fountain, take youth. She's the fountain of youth. My wife just gets younger and younger every year. Do you know people actually come up to her and say, now, how old is your husband? Because you just look like he just robbed the cradle and you look young. And I'm like, she's older than me. She's older than me by 3 years, but you would never know it. Because my wife keeps getting younger and younger. You know why? Because I find joy in her. I find joy in her. And my joy is her strength. Because the joy of the Lord that God gives me, I share it with her. And she gets strength from that. Let your wife know you find joy in her. You see, the first thing we have to know about fountains, cisterns, rivers, or any water source, no matter if we're talking about God, our wife, our business, our marketplace ministry, whatever ministry in the synagogue, ministry in the church, it doesn't matter. Whatever water source we're talking about, we need to know four basic things. Number one is this, fill this in. You got to know what areas in your life need cleansing, or there should be cleansing water or purification. The number one thing is, you need to know what areas of your life need the cleansing water of purification. Because the number one thing we saw about water in this text, it's for cleansing the outside. Amen?
Yep.
It's to cleanse. It's to purify. The priests had to be pure. The Israelites had to be pure. Everybody had to be pure before God. You couldn't come into the presence of a holy God with impure offerings or defiled hands or defiled hearts. So we need to know what areas in our life need cleansing. The second thing we need is to know, you got to know when you're dry and thirsty for water to drink. You see, I've already shared with you, the moment you're thirsty, you're already dehydrated. After service today, you guys are going to be looking for gallons of water. And make sure it's a good source of water if you're going to do that. So number one was know the areas in your life that need cleansing. Number two, know the areas in your life that are dry where you are thirsty for water to drink. If you won't admit it to yourself, it's because you probably haven't admitted it to God. There's some thirsty areas in your life. You are thirsty for stuff. Now let me tell you, if you don't get your thirst quenched from your own wife in a marriage, then some other woman can easily offer you a glass of water that you'll gratefully take, and you'll drink it, and you'll find joy in her instead of your wife. That's why husbands at an office might receive compliments from a secretary. And sadly enough, if they don't get it from their own wife, they're going to seek it somewhere else. And there's two people at fault there, because love goes both ways. The wife should be that source of joy, that source of water, to keep him from being thirsty. So wives, quench your husband's thirst. Don't let him go thirsty, trying to put him on punishment out in the doghouse. Quench his thirst. But husbands, let me tell you, your first job is to find joy in her, because she will not quench your thirst if you don't find joy in her.
Amen.
You know how to get the best service at a restaurant? Find joy in the waiters,
yeah,
and the chef, and the establishment. Rave about it. Say what an amazing job they're doing. Every time you come back, they're going to give you the best service.
Uh-huh.
Because when you find joy in them,
yep,
they're going to serve you, feed you, give you water, give you food, take care of you, because you find joy in them. Nobody wants to give food to a disgruntled customer. And you don't want to know what they do to the food when you're angry. Just a tip. I'm just saying. So we've got to know the areas that need cleansing in our life. We've got to know when we're dry and thirsty. The third thing we need to know the true source of water comes from. We need to know, it should say, where the true source of water comes from. How many know the true source of water comes from God? Know where the true source of water comes from. Where does it come from? God. Through Yeshua, by the power of the Spirit. So actually the Holy Spirit is the water. But the water of the Spirit comes through Yeshua from the Father. That's the same way we pray. We pray to God. You don't pray to Jesus. I'm sorry, Christian. You don't pray to Jesus. That's unbiblical.
Right.
Yeshua the Messiah said, in that day when I leave you, you will ask me nothing, but you will ask the Father in my name. You always pray to God the Father. Why? All good and perfect gifts come from him. Yeshua is just the messenger that brings it to you.
Amen.
In his name, in his power, in his authority. But it comes from the Father. He's the source. Did not the God of Israel say, I'm the source? Yeshua is the one bringing us the water, like the woman at the well. And the water that he brings us is the Spirit. So you pray to the Father in Yeshua's name by the power of the Spirit. Any other prayer is unbiblical. Now let me qualify some things. You can praise Yeshua. You can thank him. You can be grateful. You can even worship the Son. Because when you worship the Son or honor the Son, you honor the Father. But if you're going to ask for anything, ask the Father in my name. He never said, ask me.
Right.
He says, come to me and I'll give you the living water. But where did the water come from? Father. Just like Paul said, follow me as I follow him.
Yep.
Follow Messiah. Messiah followed his Father.
Right.
So everything leads back to the source. And the fourth and final thing, 2 minutes to spare. Know when your cistern is broken and needs to be fixed.
Amen.
And this is the examination moment in your heart. Take a moment to ask yourself, what's broken in my life and what needs to be fixed? Because you shouldn't go another day without water.
Right.
A broken sister leads to a thirsty soul. Amen? Broken sister. Now, last thing I want to show you is on the back of your outline. I actually put it on the screen today. This is what I'll be putting on Facebook. You probably can't read it from here. But just know when you see this chart all over the internet, share it with as many friends as possible. This coming week, we're going to have 6 days of manna dealing with what it means to be blessed. We're going to understand what a bad influence is in our life. We're going to understand what spiritual blindness is, like Balaam had. We'll understand what it means to be a mouthpiece for God. We'll understand his unchangeable promise. We'll understand what spiritual vision is. And we'll learn to not be unequally yoked. These are the things that we want to focus on this week as we do our devotion. How many enjoyed this message today? Would you stand for the blessing? So that's your homework for this week. Look up the devotional words online, do research, read the supporting verses I gave you, even find more verses if you can. Pray the prayer focus and ask yourself the question for a spiritual challenge every day. And guess what? You'll come back with a double portion in your spirit. Amen? Stretch your hand for the blessing. Shalom. Amen. May the Lord Adonai bless and keep you, shine his face upon you, and be gracious to you, lift up his countenance upon you, and give you perfect peace in Yeshua's name, the Prince of Peace, Hashem Yeshua. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you today.
Thank you.
Shavua Tov. So, as we get ready to bring in the elements for Kiddush, the fruit of the vine, everyone will get a cup of the fruit of the vine. And everyone will get a piece of challah bread. That'll be the second blessing. If you're used to a Christian order of doing things, you'll know that usually the bread comes first, then the Jews kind of like to wash it all down. But really, if you think about it, Messiah's blood was shed first before the provision of healing was provided. So all the provision of the bread that it is a symbol of really comes after the cup. And if you read Luke 24, after supper he lifted a cup, then he told them to break bread. And in every time the bread was eaten, the cup came first. If we read it from 1 Corinthians 11, we will assume that the order was different. But really the order has always been from the Jewish community to the Christian community. It always started with the cup first, then the bread. So we all get a cup of the fruit of the vine. This cup is a symbol of what? No, first in Judaism it's a symbol of joy. What is it a symbol of?
Joy.
Remember the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, and peace? Well, this is the fruit of the vine. So the symbol is what again?
Joy.
What do we take joy in? The joy of Shabbat, number one. The joy of our salvation. The joy in Yeshua, because he's the Lord of Shabbat. And he's also the source of our salvation. And it's a symbol of joy for every Shabbat and every feast day and holy day to set it apart as special. So we're setting apart this time we've spent today in Yeshua's name as a time that is special, full of joy. Our name, Simchat Yeshua, is actually the joy of Yeshua. In English, it would be the joy of Jesus. But we see his name in Hebrew, Yeshua, which means what? Salvation. So where do we get salvation from? Yeshua. When a person who speaks Hebrew hears that word, or that name, they know it means salvation, for he will save his people from their sins. Amen? You can lift up your cup today, and let's call upon the name of the Lord. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, vorei pri hagafen. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, creator of the fruit of the vine. Amen. L'chaim. And talking about opening up your thirst and opening up your appetite, this is the best bread in the world, challah bread. We always challah for challah. I look for it every week. Panera makes it for me every week. I get so excited and I can chill out. The worst thing is ever going out of town and forgetting to pick up a holler or telling them that somebody else will pick it up for me. Then they have to give it away, but I always think, goodness, I hope somebody buys it. I don't want to go to waste. In fact, I never like to let a holler go to waste on the Shabbat, so we always want somebody to take home the last piece, amen? Or eat it during Oneg today. So as we lift it up and thank God that Yeshua is the bread of life, born in Beit Lechem, the house of bread, as it means in Hebrew, and Haminol, the bread of life, is a sign of provision, the true manna from heaven, amen?
Amen.
Beautiful. He's the true manna that came down from heaven, but he's also, as we say in the blessing, the bread that came forth from the earth on the third day, amen? Resurrection. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam hamotzei lechem min haaretz. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth. Amen. Come on, let's sing it. Where's our way hold on, guys. We got the ukulele. Where's I need another point at? Okay, here we go. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Abba, we thank you, Lord God, for your blessings. You have fed us spiritually today. And Father, you have given us the living water, not only of your Torah, but your word from Genesis to Revelation. You have given us Yeshua, the word made flesh, but as not only our source through which we get the water that you provide as a fountain of living water, but he's the true manna that we will feast on, and he will taste sweet in our lips today as we speak of Messiah in our conversations today. And we thank you, we speak of his soon return. And Father, we thank you, Lord God, that you will also give us sweet fellowship as we bless your name for the food that you're providing. We fellowship and break bread with one another. Let our fellowship also be sweet. Let our marriages and our parenting and our businesses and our flow of income this week be sweet to us and not be bitter or grievous. And we pray, Lord God, this food would be nourishing to our bodies in Yeshua's name. We bless your name. Hashem Yeshua. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
May the Lord bless you and keep you, and make his face to shine upon you, and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you. May the Lord grant you his peace. Yiberechecha Adonai, v'yishmerecha, Yaeh Adonai, p'nav elecha v'hunecha. Adonai panav elecha ve'yaseh lecha shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and make his face to shine upon you, and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you. May the Lord grant you his peace. Elokecha Adonai V'yishmerecha Ya'er Adonai Panav Elecha V'hunecha Yisa Adonai Panav Elecha V'yaseh L'cha Shalom.